stop printing out bulletins for everyone, because, you know, it's all up on the screens anyway. And it's not really great for the environment to try to guess how many people are going to come and print it all out. But we email the information to you. And so if you ever want to have written down what's going to be on the screen so you know what's coming up, so you're prepared, you, as long as you're on our email list, we'll have that. You can get on our email list. It's free if you sign one of these little guys. This is a friendship pad. And actually, I'll get that going around. I would love to get everyone's signature on the friendship pad just so that we know who's here, who's not, what's going on, who we need to follow up with, who might be sick. Those kinds of things. It just helps us keep track of things. You know, but it's, you do the best you can. Here's the important thing to know is, you know, you're going to see some stars. It'll be up on the screen. It's also in the worship guides. That's where most people tend to like to stand up. But there are really no rules. You know, you stand up when you feel like it. If you're feeling antsy, you want to pace around in the back, you can do that. If you want to stay seated, a lot of standing up and sitting down is tiring on some people. That's okay. You're not going to offend us. It's just, you know, setting expectations. Other announcements of things we've got coming up, of course, we've got some food coming up. After service today, we're going to share food with one another. We've got a variety of breads to break as we share communion. And then we've had our folks in our community prepare for a potluck. So we'll enjoy some time together. There's a fire pit outside if you want to enjoy fellowship around the fire. That's happening this afternoon. Next week's Trinity Sunday, that's just a liturgical thing. We're just celebrating Trinity Sunday, so reminding ourselves about the doctrine of the Trinity. Our cause on the calendar this month is Meals on Wheels. So if you want to make a donation to Meals on Wheels, you can do that either by putting your check in the offering plate at the back and writing Mission of the Month on it, a cause on the calendar, or Meals on Wheels, whatever, on that memo line. We will get it to them. Or by going to our website, which is stjohnspc.org, and you can donate there, either to our general fund or to our monthly mission. And have we got a slide? I don't know if we've got a slide for it. We've got a slide for Junk Fest, September 24th. Keep an eye out for that. Father's Day is coming up, June 19th. It's a triple day because it's Father's Day. It's also our newest federal holiday, Juneteenth. And it is also my daughter's birthday. So it's the day I became a father. She's turning 2, and June 25th, we are celebrating her birthday. She's having a bubble-themed birthday because we're trying to do things based on her interests. And you're all invited. We're going to a park called
Dick Nichols Park.
Dick Nichols Park. There's a splash pad there. And yeah, you're welcome to come and celebrate Lily's birthday, not on the 19th. On the 19th, we'll be here. We'll be worshiping Jesus and getting to know one another. So,
Sunday's the 18th. Monday's the
19th. I thought it was the 19th. I could be wrong.
Maybe you're
wrong. I don't know. I could pull out a phone and check, but
you're right. I'm wrong. Right. Sorry.
Okay. Sunday is the 19th. It's official. Let's join together in the call to worship. I'll read the unbold. You're invited to read the bold. This is from Psalm 104. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
O Lord, my God, you are very great.
You are clothed with honor and majesty.
Wrapped in light for the garment.
You stretch out the heavens like a tent.
You set the beams of your chambers on the waters.
You make the clouds your chariot.
You ride on the wings of the wind.
You make the winds your messengers.
Fire and flame your ministers.
Amen. foundation piece of the service that we do every Sunday is the confession and assurance of pardon. I had the privilege of getting to lead a service at the Auberge Memory Care, which gave me an opportunity to explain some of the elements of liturgy that we do every week. And sometimes I'm remiss in not explaining them to y'all, because sometimes, we've just always done it, and we don't think about it. But some Christian churches have a tradition called reconciliation, used to be called confession, where you sit down in a booth with a priest, and you specifically confess each and every one of your sins, and then the priest gives you some prayers to pray to say you're sorry to God. And then other churches just kind of trust you to do that on your own. They say, yeah, it's good to confess your sins, but you don't need any intermediary. You don't need a clergy person. Just confess your sins to God. Our tradition here is to do something kind of in between, where we corporately speak generally of the fact that, hey, we've sinned. We've done wrong. We haven't been perfect human beings. And I don't forgive you. You haven't wronged me. But I let you know that our theology says that Jesus has already forgiven you. That's called the assurance of pardon. So, if you believe, I'm going to invite you to say together with me our prayer of, I'm sorry. And we have a tradition of reminding you kind of the invitation to that out of 1 John 1:9. I almost didn't say that this week. How weird would that have been? 1 John 1:9 says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Therefore, in humility and faith, why don't you join me in the prayer of confession, saying with me, Almighty God, you love us, but we have not loved you. You call, but we have not listened. We walk away from neighbors who need. Wrapped in our own concerns, we condone evil, prejudice, warfare, and greed. God of grace, help us to admit our sin, so that as you come to us in mercy, we may repent, turn to you, and receive forgiveness through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer.
Thank you.
right? Not just individually, but as a people, as a tribe, as a nation, as a city, and as a community gathered for worship. And so, if you'd like to, I'd like to invite you to share the things that are on your heart, your mind this week, the things that you're praying for. Sometimes we say your joys and your concerns, things you're thanking God for, things you're asking God for. Mary's got one.
I have a joy that Bob received a diploma for being a resident of Marbridge for 60 years.
Woo!
Peace.
Peace.
situation.
I'm happy to be here.
I'm good to meet you, Ben. Hello. I'm Ryan. Thanks for joining us this week. Mrs. David?
Yeah, we met.
Yeah. Oh, well, here, I haven't greeted y'all.
Sorry.
Peace be with you. No problem. I'm just happy to walk through.
Can you stay for lunch?
Yeah. It's pretty likely I'll stick around for a little bit. Yeah.
Cool. It's Mexican themed. Tamale, the chili con queso, it's all the good stuff. Next time.
Our next hymn is not a new one. We've sung this a couple times this year. Let's join together in Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. And where's my wife? Let's finish.
Teach me song, give them this song, John.
Let's read together from Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now, there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each of them heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, the residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages. We hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. "Men of Judea," it was 22:22, probably would have said, "People of Judea, and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams, even upon my slaves, both men and women. In those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy, and I will show portents in heaven above, and signs on earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. And then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There is so much to talk about with Pentecost. There's so much going on, it's good that I get to preach on it, you know, once a year, at least, which, ironically, I don't feel that way about, things like Christmas. Yeah, you come around to the Nativity story, I think maybe because we have the Advent beforehand, and I'm kind of, we've talked about Christmassy things for a while, and then I'm like, oh boy, Christmas Eve service coming, I gotta come up with something new to say about the baby in the manger. But Pentecost is just so much. So what I want to do, I want to remind you of an analogy that I have often used, that if you've been coming to this church a while, you might be getting tired of. And Scripture is like a jewel that you can hold up to the light and turn in different directions, and it'll shine a rainbow of different colors depending on how you turn it. I want to take this jewel, this Acts chapter 2 jewel, and I want to hold it up particularly to the light of Genesis chapter 1. I want to talk about similarities and differences between this Pentecost story and this Tower of Babel story. Because in a lot of ways, they contrast each other. I mean, they have things in common, right? We're building something, and languages are involved. But in Genesis, the Old Testament, God confounds the languages. God has a problem with the people getting along too well, because what they're doing is they're getting along too well, and they're using that to do evil things. They're They're building this tower, and they're trying to replace God. And God says, so therefore, I'm going to confound their languages to keep them from destroying themselves by, really, by technology. I mean, Tower of Babel is kind of an anti-tech story. If you just read that alone, they've invented bricks. Oh my gosh. Society's never going to be the same. It's gonna, their attention span is going to go way down. They're not going to spend all this time building things. They're going to be able to build things way faster now that they have bricks. We got to stop this. We got to slow this down. We got to make it back like it used to be. Alright? But then in Pentecost, God comes in and he does the opposite. And he says, by the Holy Spirit, I'm going to allow everybody to understand. I'm going to allow all the languages, and there are different interpretations, but my reading of the text is actually not necessarily that the Spirit descended on all the Christians in the room, and the Christians each started speaking a different language, i.e. one of them started speaking Latin, one of them started speaking Spanish, one of them started speaking Chinese, but rather that they all started speaking in a language that could be heard by each one of them. So somebody shows up from, you know, a part of Libya belonging to the Cyrene, and hears everybody speaking in Libyanese. I don't know what language they spoke in Libya belonging to the Cyrene in that era. I think they speak Arabic now, but that's the thing, right? Like, a miracle happened that breaks down the division that had been created between people. And then Peter stands up and he says, this isn't like disorganization. This isn't chaos. This isn't undoing the structure that we needed so long ago. This is actually what was the plan all along. This is what Joel talked about. And Joel to Peter was already ancient, right? Joel was hundreds of years earlier. He says, you know, Joel said that one day there would come a time when the Spirit would be for everyone. One way to read the story of the Old Testament is it begins in the beginning, right? Julie Andrews, can you please? Very good place to start. And then there's this winnowing down, right? We begin with the creation of the heavens and the earth and everything in it, and then we kind of winnow down. And we've got, we need to focus on just Noah and his family. And well, we need to focus on just Abraham and his family. And, eventually it gets to the place where I'm focusing on just one king. Can I get just one righteous person? Can I get just one? Can anybody follow the law? Can I get a remnant, a faithful remnant of Israel? And then it turns out we finally get that faithful remnant, and his name is Jesus. We got one person. The one Messiah, one person who's going to follow the law after hundreds of years of specifying, winnowing down and saying, okay, it's going to be, I'm going to pick just one nation. And then actually from among the nation, I'm going to pick just one tribe. I'm going to pick just the priests, right? And the priests are going to do this. And then, can I get the good priest? Get one priest who's going to open it. Oh, there's a great high priest. And Jesus shows up. And that's the point of the New Testament. That's the kind of apex, the intersection of the X-shaped, call it chiasm, theology, the X-shaped scripture is Jesus Christ. We narrow down until there's just one person who can fulfill it. And then after Jesus comes and teaches and preaches and dies and resurrects and ascends, last week Jesus ascended, left it all in our hands, then there's a widening. And it goes out from this one place, it goes from this one person to this 12. And then it goes from the 12 to a gathering, to a church, of a bunch of Christians gathering in one room, celebrating Pentecost, celebrating this Jewish holiday. And then it goes out from there, and Peter says, it's going to keep going out. It's going to go out to Jerusalem and Judea and all of Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And that becomes the focus of the New Is the gospel widening from a narrowing, from a specifying, from a winnowing down, out to a widening, out to the ends of the earth, to all nations. So Pentecost becomes a very, very important day to remember the contributions of all nations. In fact, the Greek word for nations is ethnos. So the contributions of all ethnicities, of all people of the world, all tribes and tongues, all languages, all of us are different, and yet our difference is valid. We all have different specializations, we all have different gifts. And we all, so many times in this verse we hear about all, are involved. The tongues of fire fall on everybody in the room. Not just the ones with the gift of gab and the ability and the interest in being friendly, but everyone is involved. And that's why when we share communion this week, we have a variety of breads. Normally there's just one bread, but we like the image at Pentecost in particular of breads from all over the world. That's why we wanted to have a potluck this evening, afternoon, because all of us individually have different ways of cooking, different styles of preparing food, and when we bring those things together, we get a more savory, wonderful experience than we each did alone. And that is why it is so important as Christians to be anti-racist. That is why it is so important as Christians to kind of push back against the winnowing down theology that we've sometimes seen in the United States, that separates me from you, that says, oh, well, I'm Presbyterian, you're Methodist. I say debts when I pray the Lord's Prayer, you say trespasses. How can we possibly? And instead say, hey, difference is good. We're going out. We're reaching out into all nations, into all the world. We're including more. We're widening our arms for the big hug. And doing that isn't a compromise. It's not a watering down. It is a deep, theological, biblically based commitment that we have, something that God has obligated us to since the days of the prophet Joel, and even before. This was in God's playbook from the beginning of time, when the whole heavens and earth were created by God, and God intends to bless every nation through the one nation, and then the one patriarch, and the one Messiah that goes out to everyone. And so, in remembrance of that, let's share the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Lord God, truly it is right, always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise. For you are the God who brings us together. You are the God who teaches us what is right before we know it. You are the God who created the heavens and the earth and every language upon the earth, every culture upon the earth, every nation. You are the God of everything, and you allow us to benefit from all of the diversity that you have created. We thank you, Lord, that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, and he said, take, eat, in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and he said, in this cup is the blood of the new covenant, is poured out for you and for many for the remission of sins. As often as you drink this, remember me. So whenever we eat this bread, drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's saving death until he comes again. I like to remind you every month when we take communion, but this month especially, this is not a Presbyterian table. It's not my table. You might think it's St. John's table. It's not. This is the Lord's table. And the Lord Jesus invites everyone who wants to come to the feast and share in the meal. So, let's sing together, and as you like, we will serve you. Mary, would you be available to serve? Would you like to serve bread or wine today?
Wine.
You can be the wine. All right. Yeah, you can come as you feel led, or Dave is going to help dismiss you, and we are going to sing as it's our tradition for everyone more. Oh, we missed the singers. That's all right. We'll do that at the end.
Thank you.
So, interesting church history fact. When we study history, it's not entirely clear when the tradition of communion came to be this specific thing that happens like inside a church service where we have, you know, a little morsel of bread and a little bit of wine. But it seems that over the course of history, there were a number of plagues and events like COVID that caused us to have to ask the question, okay, what portion of the communion tradition can we hold on to and how can we manage it? And in the first century, among the Christians gathered for Pentecost, communion was part and parcel of a full meal, a feast. You might even say a potluck. It talks in the Corinthians about rich people bringing more food than poor people and all of them sharing equally. And so I do want to encourage you to join us for the potluck, to join in the fellowship, and to partake even in the bread that has been on this table as part of the diversity of the meal that you enjoy next. Now I want to leave you with a blessing that has been a tradition in our community, saying this. As you go into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Love, honor all people. Love and serve one another, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And let all God's people say, Alleluia. Alleluia.